Hello. Good afternoon to everyone. 11th bio students, please join to the class. Very soon, I am going to start the second part of the first chapter in 11th biology, that is living world. Hello, dear students, please be seated. In this session, today we will go through the contents, the different principles involved in binomial nomenclature, different examples of binomial names in different plants, the taxonomic hierarchy and its representation, the different taxonomical aids that we are used to identify the plants and animals and their use. So our objective in this session is to understand the different biological concepts involved in this main content area, and you must be able to explain the various rules involved in binomial nomenclature and get an idea about how the plants are classified, and you have to gain the knowledge about various taxonomic aids and its application. Now, our expected learning outcome in this chapter, in this session, after doing all these four different content areas that I have mentioned here, you must be able to explain the various concepts that is mentioned in this four content area. And you must be able to explain the various rules or principles involved in binomial nomenclature of an organism. And you must be able to write, represent schematically, and describe the taxonomic hierarchy of organisms. And you must be able to identify as well as write the scientific names correctly. Before going in detail into the content area, the previous knowledge that is needed for learning these concepts, that is identification, classification, and nomenclature. So identification, that is, what is identification? Already we have learned in the first session, correct observation of an organism. Then after observing the organism's characters correctly, that means after identifying the organism, you can arrange the organisms into different categories, groups, that is classification. Then after classification, you have to give the names to the organism. That is what is called as nomenclature. So these are the previous knowledge that is needed to go to the next content area. So our next content area in this session is the first one, that is, what are the rules or principles involved in binomial nomenclature? You have already learned about the concept of binomial nomenclature. Binomial nomenclature means, that is, scientific name, giving two names to a particular organism. That is genus name and species name. So genus name that begins with a capital letter, and species name begins with a small letter. First, the word genus name. will come and it is followed by species name. And these words are, normally they are Latin in origin and it must be written in italics. But there are difficulties in writing in italics. So when we are writing, that means when it is handwritten, these two words must be separately underlined in order to show their Latin origin. Then after writing this binomial name, the abbreviation of the name of the author, that must be written after the binomial name of the organism. For example, Mangifera indica. After that, there it is written LINN. This LINN is the abbreviation of the author Linnaeus, who has done this naming, or who named this mango plant as Mangifera indica. So these are the different principles that are involved in binomial nomenclature. A very important question, 3 mark for your examination. Then there are some other examples also. For example, human beings, man, its binomial name is Homo sapiens. Homo sapiens. Homo is genus name and sapiens is species name. Then if it is a housefly, its scientific name is Musca domestica. Musca is genus name and domestica is species name. Wheat plant, that is Triticum aestivum. Triticum is genus name and aestivum is species name. Coconut plant, Coccus nucifera. Coccus nucifera. So like this, there are so many different binomial names mentioned in your syllabus. Now the next aspect, that is classification. Classification means grouping, mode of arrangement of organisms into different groups, into different categories, and it is based on observable characters. And why we have it to classify the organisms? It is for easy identification. You know, when you are going to the textile for purchasing any of the dress item, you can identify the items very easily because it is well arranged in different sections. So for easy identification, we can use classification of organisms. Otherwise, studying each and every organism separately is a difficult task. Now, taxonomy. What is taxonomy? You know, it is a branch of biology and it is dealing with the classification of living organisms. That means plants as well as animals into different taxa, into different group, into different categories. That is what is called as taxonomy. Now, various steps involved in taxonomy. Taxonomy is not a single method, not a single process. It involves different steps. First one is characterization. Correct observation of a particular organism. Characterization, then identification, then classification, and finally nomenclature. So 4 different steps are involved in taxonomy. First step, characterization of organism. Second, identify the organism. Then classification or grouping the organism. And the 4th one, that is nomenclature, naming of an organism. And here you see the father of taxonomy, that is Linnaeus, Carolus Linnaeus. Now, yet another branch, systematics. Systematics involves the study of interactions between different organisms, and similarly the interaction of organism with its environment, and we are considering the evolutionary relationship between these organisms. So three aspects are coming under this heading, systematics. So it is study of organism, that is based on the interaction between the organisms. Then these organisms, they are interacting with the environment also. Then the third concept that we are including here is the evolutionary relationship between these organisms. So when we are including these three aspects, then it forms a branch that is known as systematics. And you know, this is the word that is Latin in origin. It derives from the Latin word that is systema. Its meaning is systematic arrangement of organisms. Then Carolus Linnaeus, he has written one book, and the name of the book is Systema Naturae. And similarly, in this sequence, here I would like to add one more important book, that is Historia Plantarum. Historia Plantarum. It is the book written by Theophrastus. You know who is Theophrastus? Father of botany. Now we are going to the next aspect, that is taxonomic hierarchy, taxonomic categories. So what is meant by hierarchy? That is step by step arrangement. Step by step arrangement of organisms into different groups, different categories, into different levels. So that process, that is known as taxonomic hierarchy. And each step or each level in this particular taxonomic hierarchy arrangement, that is known as taxon. And the lowest taxon is the species, and highest taxon is the kingdom. So here one page is included in this one, in this slide, and it is the page from this book Systema Naturae, written by Carolus Linnaeus. The first one, that is species. The first step in the first step or the basic unit of classification, the first taxon, simplest taxon, that is species. Now, what is the definition of a species? For example, human beings, sapiens, are the species. So these species, all the members in a species, they are capable of interbreeding freely. So they are freely interbreeding group of individuals. And these individuals, they have some fundamental similarities, as well as there are some morphological differences. If there is no morphological difference, then very difficult to distinguish the species. So there are certain morphological differences, and at the same time they have a fundamental similarities, and all the individuals in a particular species, that is capable of interbreeding freely between them. So one should be able to distinguish this one species from a related species. Suppose two species are very closely related, then how these two species must be identified? So it is based on certain morphological characters differences. For example, here you can see three organisms. One is Panthera tigris, tiger, and the other is Panthera leo, that is a lion, and Panthera pardus, leopard. So these are three different species showing most of the similar characters but some morphological differences also. Now the next second step, second taxon, that is genus. Now what is genus? A group of related species. Many species are involved in a genus and all these species are interrelated. They show common characters and at the same time they show more differences also. So such a group of related species and these related species which shows more common characters and some differences, morphological differences also, that is what is called as genus. For example, here you can see potato, then they are present in the tomato, then brinjal. So these three belong to different species but they all are included in a single genus, that is Solanum. Solanum tuberosum, potato, Solanum nigrum, tomato, and Solanum melongena, brinjal. So all belongs to the same genus Solanum but species different. Similarly, in the case of animal, lion, Panthera leo, leopard, Panthera pardus, and tiger, Panthera tigris. Three different species, but all belong to the same genus, Panthera. Now the third category, third taxon, family. Again, group of related genera. A group of related genus, genera, they will show many similarities but different morphological vegetative characters. So these families, they are characterized on the basis of vegetative characters as well as reproductive features. For example, here I have included three plants. One is Solanum, then the other is Petunia, third one is Datura. So these three plants, they are belonging to different genus but included in the same family. Which family? Solanaceae. Then the genus Panthera and Felis. In the case of animals, genus Panthera and Felis. And these two genus that comes under the family Felidae. The next step, next taxon, that is order. A group or assemblage of similar families. And these similar families, they exhibit some of the similar characters. Hence, we are including these similar families in the order, in the next group, that is order. For example, in the case of plants, Volvulaceae, and the another family, that is Solanaceae. So these two families showing similar characters, so it is included in the order Polymoniales. Then in the case of animals, two family, that is one is Felidae and the other is Canidae. So this comes under the order Carnivora. Order is Carnivora. Then we are going to the next one, that is next taxon, class. Class means it includes a group of related orders, similar orders, showing similar characters, that is included in the taxon class. For example, here there's a primata, you can see primata here, and here you can see the carnivora. So these are two orders, primata, all the primates, and this carnivora. These two, both are included in the class mammalia, mammals. Now next is phylum. Next higher category, and it includes related classes. For example, phylum Chordata. You know, phylum Chordata and phylum Vertebrata, non-chordates, like that. So phylum Chordata. So here phylum Chordata, that includes all the classes, like class Pisces, that means fishes, class Amphibians, class Reptiles, Reptilia, class Aves or birds, and class Mammals. So related classes, classes that shows relation, similarities, that is known as phylum. So all these classes, Pisces, Amphibia, Reptilia, Aves, and Mammals, all are included in the phylum Chordata based on some of the similarities. Now, what are the main characteristics of chordates? You have learned the same aspect in your 9th class. So all the chordates, they have a notochord. Now what is notochord? It is an embryonal supporting skeletal structure. Dorsal supporting skeletal structure present in the embryonic stage. It is replaced by vertebral column or backbone in chordates, invertebrate organisms. Then another character is dorsal tubular nerve cord. Dorsal tubular nerve cord. Then there are so many other characters also, presence of pharyngeal gill slits. So like this, and post anal tail. So like this, there are so many other characters also for these chordates. So since they have a common characters, they are included in the same phylum, that is Chordata. Example, now in the case of plants, it is not a phylum. The word phylum we can use only for animals. And in the case of plants, in the place of a phylum, we are using the term division. So in this division, there is the inclusion of a class, related classes. For example, class Monocotyledonae, that means all the monocot plants, and class Dicotyledonae, that means all the dicot plants. So they are included in the division. Which division? Angiospermae. Angiosperms. Angion means covering, sperma means seed. So here in these two plants, their seeds are well covered. Then the last one, that is kingdom, the highest one, highest category, highest taxon, the complex taxon, that is kingdom. All the animals, they are coming under which kingdom? Animal kingdom or kingdom Animalia. Then all kinds of plants, algae, bryophytes, pteridophytes, gymnosperms, angiosperms, monocots, dicots, all these plants, they are coming under the kingdom plant kingdom or kingdom plantae. So we can classify the entire organism into two category, two group, two kingdom, kingdom plantae and kingdom Animalia. Now, how it is represented? That means schematically represent taxonomic hierarchy. So here on the right side, you can see an abbreviation. No need to by heart these things. It will be easy for you to write in the same order. When you are learning this simple abbreviation form, it is easy. Otherwise, step will be in reverse manner also, and you will lose your mark. So it is a very important question, 3 mark, that is schematically represent the taxonomic hierarchy of organisms. So yaad karne ke liye abbreviation KPDCO, FGS, you know FGS abbreviation given in your textbook, figures ke liye. So FGS, what term yaad ho gaya? FGS. Then KPDCO, KPDCO. So KPDCO, FGS. Ab K for what? K for kingdom. P for what? P for phylum in the case of animals. And D for what? Division in the case of plants. So phylum is applicable for animals and division for plants. So K, P, D. C for what? Class. O for order. F for what? Family. G for genus. And S for what? Species. So, yaad ho gaya? K, P, D, C, O, F, G, S. K for kingdom. P for phylum. D, division. C, class. O, order. F, family. G, genus. S, species. So these are the abbreviations and this is the sequence. Now, how you will represent this one? When you are observing this correctly, here there is the arrow representation, arrow mark. Basic unit. What is the basic simple unit of classification or the simplest taxon? Species. So, species, then genus, then family, order, class, phylum, division, and kingdom is the topmost complex highest hierarchy. So, when you are writing, it is easy for you to start from the top to bottom, but when you have to put the arrow in the upward direction only. Put the arrows in the upward direction starting from species. You put the arrow one by one. Now we are going to the next aspect. Very important concept here is taxonomical aids. So what is taxonomical aid? Aid means helping. Anything that helps to understand the taxonomy, grouping, classification of organisms. So that is taxonomical aids. So why we should study taxonomy? What is the application? What is the importance, relevance of taxonomical studies? So taxonomical studies are used in agriculture, then in forestry, industry, and it helps in knowing about the different bio resources, biological resources that are available in our nature, and the different types of plants and animals that are present in the biosphere, that is biodiversity. So when we know about these taxonomical aspects, or if we are learning taxonomy or studying taxonomy, naturally it can be applied in these different branches: agriculture, for food production, for cultivation of crops, high yielding varieties and their proper care, and harvesting, storing, distribution, everything. Then for forestry and in different industrial purpose, your useful biological resources for making different valuable items, medicines and all. And you can gain an idea about the different biodiversity present in the biosphere. So it is important. Now, what are the different taxonomical aids that you can use for identifying a particular organism, for identifying a plant, or for identifying an animal? What are the different taxonomical aids that can be used? You might have heard about these herbarium. Herbarium sheets are available, separate white colored drawing sheet that is type available, that is known as herbarium sheets, meant for making herbarium only. So in this herbarium, what we are using is, we are collecting some of the specimens, plant specimens. Then plant specimen, when we are collecting, it must include a root, stem, leaf, buds, flowers and even fruits, everything must be there. So these plant specimens we are collecting, we will collect, and after that this must be dried, then it must be pressed well, preserved on the sheets, and it is after drying and pressing, it must be pasted on the herbarium sheets. So it acts as a storehouse of different plant specimens. And after doing all these things, these sheets are arranged properly according to a particular universally accepted system of classification. Then only it can be used by other people for reference purpose. So it must be arranged properly based on the accepted method of classification. A herbarium sheet that must contain different informations, that is, it must contain the date of a collection of the specimen, then the place of a collection, kahan se collect kiya, kab collect kiya, then kon collect kiya, collector ka naam. Here collector means the one who collects the plant specimen, not the district collector. So the name of the collector must be there. Then it's different in names. Plant ka alag alag naam chahiye. That means local name, English name and botanical name. That means anybody who wants to identify the plant, that can be identified from this herbarium sheet. So all possible names are included in this herbarium sheet. Then the description of the entire family, its botanical name, genus, species, order, family, everything based on that taxonomic hierarchy, all the information must be available. It serves as a quick reference. Because all these relevant informations are available in this sheet, it acts for a system, quick reference for taxonomic studies. These are some of the examples of herbarium sheets that you can see here, with all the relevant informations written. Now, the second one, you might have heard about these botanical gardens. You might have visited also, I think. So, botanical garden. So, these botanical gardens that contains what? Collection of plants. That is living plants. But herbarium sheet contains dead specimens. Botanical garden, it is a collection of living plants. So, it is again a Cook reference. Moreover, it is highly colorful and interesting for the children to see and enjoy. Now, each plant here is having its different names. Scientific name is well represented with its family, order, all aspects of classification is mentioned. There are certain examples of these botanical gardens. Famous botanical garden in England, that is known as it is located in Kew in England. Then Indian botanical garden, that is located in Howrah, Kolkata in India. Then NBRI, another abbreviation question, NBRI. N for national, B for botanical, R for research, and I for institute. So, National Botanical Research Institute, it is located in Lucknow, India. So, these are some of the important botanical gardens. Here is one of the abbreviation question, important one. You can see a view of this botanical garden Kew in England. Very beautiful one with the different plants. Then Indian botanical garden Howrah, Kolkata. A view of this lovely plants that you can see here. And again at another view of the same one, Howrah Botanical Garden, different plants here you can enjoy. Now, and how it is different from a botanical garden? So museums contain preserved specimens of plants and animals. That means again, dead specimens, dead collections. So it possesses collection of preserved plants and animals specimens. That is the dead one. We are using it for studies, reference. And these are there in our institutions, schools as well as colleges we are having. Nowadays, keeping animal specimen is banned. So these specimens, they are kept in specific jars or even containers in some of the preservative solutions. The commonly used preservative solution is formalin. The plants or animals, they are kept in these preservative solutions. They are in dry specimens. Insects are also preserved in insect boxes. Different types of insects that preserved in insect box. And there are birds or even mammals, rabbit, rat, etc. They are kept as stuffed specimens. Inner parts, internal visceral organs are removed and stuffed with some other materials and it is kept in the lab. So, they are stuffed specimens. Then, skeleton of some of the animals can also be used. They are also present in the museums. So here you can see some of the museum specimens. They are kept in the jars with proper sealed lids and these solutions, formalin or even other preservative solutions are also here inside to preserve the specimens. Here insect box, different types of insects are preserved. Dead specimens. seven insect boxes. Here also you can see the same. Again, there are a lot of other organisms, bats and all, that is preserved. Here also, these are stuffed specimens. Internal visceral organs are removed and filled with some other materials, and it is kept preserved in the lab for further identification and studies. Now coming to zoo or zoological parks. So zoological park means these are the places where we can see zooans, animals, wild animals. And these wild animals are kept under protected environment, natural environment. And there are people who will take care of these organisms. So it will help us to understand about their different characters, their habitat, habits, their behavior, feeding behavior, breeding behavior, all these aspects that must be studied from these zoo only. Then another important aspect coming here is keys. It is a very new term for you people. Keys are used for identifying plants as well as animals, and it is based on both similarities as well as differences. So they have a contrasting pairs of characters. Contrasting means different. So they have a contrasting pairs of characters, or contradictory are given in pairs. So that is known as a couplet. And from these couplet of characters, we have to select the correct choice. And the other one that is not correct, not suitable for identification of the concerned plant or the animal, that must be rejected. And there are two statements in a couplet. So each statement present in that couplet, that is known as a lead, because it is leading to identify to the next character. So keys are analytical in nature. One by one we will analyze the character and see the same character whether it is applicable to the plants that present in our hand for identification. And when we are preparing a key, there are so many aspects we have to take into account. That is, we should always use constant characters. Never select variable characters or seasonal characters or changing characters. That characters must be constant, fixed. Then correct measurements we have to use. Never say the leaf is large, the leaf is small, the leaf is broad. So we have to measure and say exactly. Then never use any of the negative terms. For example, stipule is not present. So instead, we have to use positive terms, that is, stipule is present. And always start with the choices of the couplet with the same word. That means seeds. For example, we are giving the character of a seed of a particular plant. So we will say the seeds are round, or we will say the seeds are oblong. So like this we have to say. And when we are saying different pairs of choices, then it must start with different words. For example, flower ka character bata rahe, flower is white. Then what is the next character? That means we are going to the next character. That is, the flower may be having sepals and these sepals may be free. So there are certain flowers where the sepals are fused. Then in some of the plant the flower is red in color. And we will go to the next character. That means the size of the petal measurement we will say. For example, corolla is 1 to 2 millimeter in length. Or fir corolla is 2 to 3 centimeters in length. Like that we can say the character. So in this way it is, these leads are going on. So analyze each and every lead based on these characters and identify whether these characters are applicable to the plant that is in question. And finally, we will come to the conclusion, correct identification of the plant. So in addition to these things, these taxonomic aids, there are other taxonomical aids also. For example, flora, then manuals, there are monographs and catalogs. So all these are used for identifying the organisms. So these are some of the diagrams of the zoo that is mentioned here. You can see different types of animals. Now, flora. Very beautiful flowers you can see here. All these are orchid flowers. Monkey-faced orchid you can see here. And this one you see, it is having the face of a, or it is a bird type. Just like a bird, it is appearing. All these are beautiful orchid plants. So flora refers to plants. So actual characters, actual accounts of all the habitat distribution of a plant that must be given in this particular flora. Here also you can see different types of plants with beautiful flowers. Then the next one is manuals. It will give information for you to identify the different name of the species found in an area. Monograph, mono means single. And it possesses the information of a particular taxon. Only one taxon, its characters are described here in the monograph. Now, for today's assignment, are you ready? Okay, then you can see your assignment here. Identify the following. One, father of botany. Aristotle, Theophrastus, Darwin, and Robert Hooke. So out of these four options, you have to identify who is the father of botany. Can anybody say the answer? Yes, Theophrastus is the correct option. Now, scientific study of diversity of organisms and their interaction with the other organisms and evolutionary relationship. So that is what is known as DASH. What is the answer? Yes, systematics. Who discovered binomial nomenclature? Who discovered binomial nomenclature? Very good. Carolus Linnaeus. Then expand ICBN. What is ICBN? International Code for Botanical Nomenclature. NBRI, National Botanical Research Institute. Then your next question is, match the following. Correctly, you have to match these things given in section A and B. Family. What is the correct option? Yes, Solanaceae. Family, Solanaceae. Kingdom. Kingdom what? Which is the kingdom? Kingdom Plantae. Then, order. Order mein kaun si aayega? Polymonials. Then, species. Species, Solanum. Sorry, species is tuberosum. And genus is Solanum. That means Solanum tuberosum. That is the scientific name of this particular plant. Then the sixth question is, schematically represent taxonomic hierarchy. Taxonomic hierarchy ko aapko schematically likhna hai. Here what you have it to memorize? KPDCO FGS. And reverse arrow starting from species to kingdom. Good. What is the binomial nomenclature? Definition. Then explain the various principles involved in it. What is binomial nomenclature? Naming of an organism by giving two names. The names are genus name and species name. Then what are the principles involved in it? What are the principles involved in it? It possesses two names, genus name and species name. Genus name we will write first. It is followed by species name. Then genus name begins with a capital letter. Species name begins with a small letter. It must be written in italics. If handwritten, it must be underlined separately. And after writing the name, we have to write the abbreviation of the author. So these are the various principles involved in binomial nomenclature. So today we have completed the first chapter, Living World. I think you gained all the concepts. If you have any doubts, we can clear it on the next session. Thank you. Stay home, stay safe, and study well. Enjoy. Bye.